I just didn't want to live. So I just thought, if I'm going to die, if I'm going to kill myself, I should take some drugs, you know?
Personally, I don't think anybody should be doing drugs, kids or adults.
I've experimented with many drugs. I got out of it before it got me.
You gotta know yourself, and you gotta know your dope if you're gonna do that. If that's what you do, own your business and be business-minded about it. Don't let it take control of your life.
We've been to the drug scene, man, and there's nothing like being straight.
Hi, I'm Kurt Loder. People love drugs, you may have noticed. Apparently, they always have. Starting with alcohol, the use of which dates back some 10,000 years, and running up through the discovery of opiates and stimulants to the latest designer psychedelics, drugs are an established and problematic part of the human experience. Puzzling, too. Why, for example, are some drugs, such as coffee, tobacco, and alcohol in this country today, officially okay to use, while others, such as heroin, cocaine, and marijuana, are deeply illegal? The reasons for these legal distinctions aren't always clear. But the consequences of crossing the line into illicit drug use are anything but ambiguous, as any number of currently incarcerated young Americans can testify. Those now dead, of course, from Jim Morrison to River Phoenix, are no longer able to testify to anything. Nevertheless, recent studies suggest that young people are once again experimenting with drugs in increasing numbers, especially tobacco and marijuana. And since it's often difficult for people to get straight information on this subject, we're going to spend the next hour taking a very close look at drugs, what they are, what they do to people who use them,
Help!
And how well or poorly official government prohibition, the 80-year-long war on drugs, has worked. We'll meet a typical all-American kid whose enthusiasms include wrestling, music, and marijuana, and one of the many Grateful Dead fans targeted by drug police who's doing jail time for his involvement with LSD. We'll also visit a young woman in England whose life revolves entirely around her heroin habit, and a crack dealer from New York City who found himself forcibly retired at the age of 14. And we'll travel to the Netherlands for a look at some radical approaches that could become the drug policies of the 21st century. Through all of this, we'll try to determine why such high levels of violence are associated with the drug trade today, and why it is that young people feel a need to take drugs in the first place.
Most people go out and say, hey, you know, let's go get stoned or something. They think it's going to be fun.
Sometimes when times are bad, people, you know, turn to drugs to try to relieve the tension.
I think a lot of people do it for just to break the law.
There hasn't been any progress in the war on drugs, since the campaign started.
The notion that government can simply stop people from consuming substances that they clearly wish to consume was tested most extensively from 1919 to 1933, when the drinking of alcohol in this country was officially made illegal. And the result? Well, the result of prohibition was instructive. People tended not only to drink more and more highly alcoholic beverages, they also tended to lose their respect for the law in general. As for the bootleggers and smugglers who provided all the illicit alcohol that fueled the jazz age of the 1920s, they tended, in the absence of sensible regulation, to grow exceedingly violent and vastly wealthy and powerful. The attempt to force people to stop drinking alcohol was one of the more catastrophically misconceived social policies in this country's history. With the failure of prohibition, the forces of intolerance turned their attention to another inebriant they didn't much like.
Have you ever met that funny reefer man? Oh, that funny, funny, funny reefer man.
One of the men charged with running the great failed experiment of alcohol prohibition was Harry J. Anslinger, who by 1931 had been named U.S. Commissioner of Narcotics and soon became a driving force in the demonization of marijuana, the ancient weed that had always been as legal as milk and Bibles, but which was now said by Anslinger and his associates to be a root cause of violent and perverted crime. The newspaper stories offered in support of this theory were anecdotal at best, and often featured black and Hispanic marijuana users who were typically seen as a threat to blameless white youth.
If you want a good smoke, try one of these.
You must stamp out this frightful assassin of our youth, the dread marijuana in particular.
These scare tactics worked. In October of 1937, following hearings filled largely with the testimony of police officials, the Marijuana Tax Act was passed, and marijuana smoking in this country became effectively illegal. By the late 1940s, while the occasional pot-smoking movie star such as Robert Mitchum was being made an example of, a new generation of writers and cultural adventurers, the Beats, spearheaded a renewed interest in marijuana and other drugs as accessories to art. The government fought back with anti-marijuana films intended for classroom use.
You rather look down on my generation for getting hung up on smoking and drinking, knowing it's bad for us. You think we're stupid, but does that make your generation so all-fired smart for getting hung up on grass?
So what did the medical community make of all this? Well, the American Medical Association considered marijuana a dangerous drug, but a number of the government's own medical reports over the course of 50 years found no evidence to support that view, and by the 1960s, despite the ongoing federal anti-pot campaign, marijuana was back in a big way.
The prevailing attitude was that you did drugs to raise your consciousness, expand your mind, and find out something about yourself. It wasn't just to get high. It had to have a higher justification.
Today, marijuana is experiencing yet another renaissance, and once again, its enthusiasts are celebrating it openly.
Welcome to Georgia Noble's third annual Great Atlanta Pot Festival!
People can come have a really good time. No one hurts each other and no one gets arrested, and it's all just a very fun afternoon.
It's like this and like that and like this and it's like that and like this and like along with neo-hippie marijuana like enthusiasm, pot, now more potent than ever, is also being championed on the hip-hop scene.
Right now on the streets, the chronic is the bomb buds, you know.
Turning up on the covers of top 10 albums and packed into hollowed-out cigars called blunts.
This t-shirt represents weed.
In the 90s, the marijuana leaf has also made a comeback as a fashion statement. Pot smokers have even taken to cable access TV.
Hello, welcome to Jay and B on the Rocks.
I'm Jay.
And I'm B.
And this is a joint.
This is a joint.
And we're gonna smoke it now.
As has been the case for the last 30 years or so, a lot of young people use marijuana today, or at least experiment with it. Some, of course, overuse it and sink into the dim and distant mode associated with hardcore potheads. Others seem able to handle it with no problems. Here are two stories from the current marijuana front.
It's like there's a big smoke screen over one's life, you know? It's just sort of like you're kind of half there.
It's not like I'm trying to commit suicide or anything, but it's no worse than drinking coffee or smoking a cigarette or drinking a beer or, you know, taking a shot of tequila.
I go to Marijuana Addicts Anonymous. I'm 24 years old, and I'd like to be anonymous because I feel there's a stigma attached to pot smoking.
My name's Chris Pearson. I go to Guthrie High School. I wrestle for varsity. I use recreational use of marijuana. And like I say, I don't smoke it, but maybe more than once or twice a week. That's all I have time for, and if that much. I don't feel that it affects my wrestling career at all.
What at one time had seemed like a really good time with pot started to make me feel more and more depressed. Maybe it's a little bit like a downer. You know, it's a depressant. That's the nature of the drug.
If somebody's, depressed about either girlfriend or boyfriend, you know, I don't think that they should sit down and smoke pot. It sort of makes you dwell on things. It's more of a happy time thing.
They say the thing about pot is you forget. It's so true. I stopped feeling a lot, you know. I just got really desensitized.
It affects your judgment. You know, I definitely don't promote any use, you know, while driving a vehicle or going to school or anything like that. I think you should be at school to learn. If you use it more than, you know, 2-3 times a week, you really need to watch yourself and think what you're doing. If you're smoking that much, there's not really that much time to be real productive.
I don't think it's good for the lungs. Sometimes it would hurt my throat. One thing about pot is it really, really can demotivate. You know, just a lot of times I remember smoking with people, you know, just being sort of like a potato.
It doesn't seem like that much of a risk whenever, you know, you're out with your friends. Somebody pops one up and starts smoking it. It really snaps you into reality whenever you see one of your best friends get busted with it, and all the money it costs, and all the hassle, and, you know, jail time and all that. That's the only thing I'm scared of about marijuana.
And since I've stopped smoking, I guess I feel like reality's opening up.
I don't think that marijuana will be illegal forever. There's no way to eradicate all the marijuana plants in the world, you know. There's just too many of them and too many people that want to smoke it.
Two takes on marijuana. It may be the most innocuous of the illicit drugs, but it too obviously can screw up your life if you make it a full-time hobby. Still, is that a legitimate reason to fine and jail users? There's a school of thought in the Netherlands that says no, as we'll discover a little later in the show. Next up, though, the lowdown on cocaine, crack, and other drugs whose dangers, unlike those of marijuana, are in very little doubt.
Cocaine, there's a good idea. I want to do a drug that makes my penis small, makes my heart explode, makes my nose bleed, and sucks all my money out of the bank. Could I do that? Could I sit in a room and sweat for 7 hours? I want to make this face all night.
Welcome back. Coca leaves, the basic shrubbery from which cocaine and, of course, crack are derived, has been cultivated in South America for more than 1,000 years. The active chemical cocaine was isolated around 1860, and in 1884, a young Viennese doctor named Sigmund Freud began using it and became highly enthused, promoting its use for everything from morphine addiction to a simple tonic for everyday well-being. By the turn of the century, cocaine was available without a prescription as an ingredient in coca wines, patent medicines, and smokable cocarettes. But the downside of cocaine ingestion, paranoia, hallucinations, heart attacks, quickly became apparent, and the drug was restricted in 1914. With the introduction in the 1930s of amphetamine, today known as speed and available without a prescription in this country under the brand name Benzedrine until 1959, demand for cocaine shrank somewhat, but it rebounded at the end of the 1960s and in the 70s became a glamour drug, or at least as glamorous as any drug can be that involves tension, sweat, bloody noses, and endless outlays of cash.
Snow, baby. Dime bag. Cocaine.
Coke, or blow, or Lady Kane, as it was also called, was snarfled up in vast piles by the rich and famous in the celebrated discotheques of the period and just about everywhere else.
What's this do? What does it do?
Makes America beautiful.
Cocaine's popularity continued into the 1980s, accompanied, not all that surprisingly, by a new and expensive fashion for celebrity rehab.
Is that what you're doing? You rolling? I used to be rolling.
I didn't see it on my own. I felt that I could feel a little something there that the band wasn't together, but I didn't know enough to stop it. Someone helped me out, you know. A bunch of people helped me out.
I called up Betty Ford Center for a friend. They wanted $13,000 for a 21-day treatment. So I said, wait a second. If you have $13,000, you don't have a problem yet!
Some stars never made it to rehab.
Coming to ya on a dusty road.
Celebrated comic John Belushi cashed in his chips with a speedball, a combination of cocaine and heroin. College basketball star Len Bias celebrated his first-round draft pick by the Boston Celtics with cocaine and died of a heart attack.
And baseball star Darryl Strawberry reportedly had a cocaine problem, too.
And then there's crack.
I got a little piece of advice for you folks. Never do a drug named after a part of your own ass, okay?
Crack was cocaine mixed with baking soda, dried, broken into rocks, and then smoked. This new, cheap form of cocaine spread the drug from the precincts of the rich and famous to the nation's hope-starved urban ghettos. What can be done about such a massively self-reinforcing drug as cocaine, every hit of which tends to make the user want to take more? The history of prohibition in this country suggests that whenever enough people want to take a drug, someone somewhere will go into the business of providing it. Increasing legal risks will simply result in increasing prices and profits. And on those relatively rare occasions when drug police finally terminate a drug kingpin, as they recently did the Colombian Pablo Escobar, another instantly arises to take his place, and the violence and degradation associated with illegal drugs continue.
DEA's got one objective: immobilize drug traffickers. Oftentimes, they do accomplish their objective. Now, in the final analysis, did that make any difference to the drug problem in America? Did it have any effect on the actual street? The answer is no.
Remember, no matter who sits at the top, these drug organizations are so well organized, they're like a Fortune 500 company. And if the president dies, does that mean the company stops? No.
You can't stop drugs. It's impossible because people want it. You can't get arrested for murder. More or less get arrested for dope. Where are you going to put it? Are you going to have to put half the population in jail?
Is there any alternative to continuing to fill 60% of our prisons with drug users while drug supplies and the number of addicts continue to grow? Well, some people think there is.
And I do feel that we would markedly reduce our crime rate if drugs were legalized.
Legalization prone Joycelyn Elders was quickly roped back into line by the startled Clinton administration. Not that Republicans have much interest in the idea either.
I think she's absolutely wrong. I don't think there's any connection between legalizing and seeing a reduction in the violence that accompanies it.
However, some black politicians who've grown weary of seeing their communities ravaged by drugs and drug laws are seriously looking for change.
If I thought that the current approach was actually leading us someplace other than the incarceration of half the African American men between the age of 18 and 35 in my community, then maybe I'd support it.
Drugs have become a confounding phenomenon in urban ghettos, where they both destroy lives and also offer an illusory hope of financial salvation to those who dare to deal in them.
I can't blame kids for turning to selling drugs. I cannot blame them, you know. They're trying to empower themselves.
But around here, you might see the drug dealers driving the nice, you know, Acura Legend, the Mercedes Benz, with their gold and their expensive clothes, but they still live here. They still live here. If they're making so much money, which they are, why don't they get out of here? They're killing their own people. You know, a lot of times you hear the kids, I make more than what you make in a year, I make it in a week. Fine, but you know what, I'm going home. You know, I don't have to worry, I don't have to watch my back.
I wasn't watching my back. I was coming out the building, and I was walking, and then I got shot.
Keon Brown, now 14, is perhaps typical. When he was barely a teenager, Brown went into the drug business in the often violent New York City borough of the Bronx. He sold some drugs, made some money, and then ran out of luck.
Drugs almost cost me my life. It cost me a lot of things. I got shot in my back. I almost died. I got paralyzed in a wheelchair. I was watching my father sell drugs. See him getting a lot of money, bringing a lot of money home. So then after a while, I started selling drugs on my own. Started selling drugs. That's it. I was making a lot of money. It was fast money. Faster money than a job. Stand anywhere. They come up to you. Ask you, do you got something? $3, $5, anything you want it to cost. That's how much it is. It keeps you high for like about 10 minutes. 5 minutes, that's it, just get high, and they come back, they want more. That's how you make the real money. That's how it is. I got busted about a couple of times, 3 times or something like that. Got busted plenty of times. First time I stayed in for like about half an hour. Next time half an hour, an hour. Then the third time I stayed in for like a month, 2 months, because I was young, and they can't do nothing. One of my goals before was just drive a fancy car and stuff, be the biggest person in drug business. My goals is now that stay in school, get a good job, everything. I got a second chance to live, and I'm gonna try to do my best I could do.
If cocaine were controlled like alcohol rather than banned outright, would Keon Brown be in a wheelchair today? Would he ever have become involved in selling the drug in the first place? Questions to ponder while we take a quick break. Stay with us though, because we'll be right back with the story of psychedelics.
Take these.
What?
Man. Take these. This will mellow you up, man.
What is this, man?
It's taken. Hey, don't take those, man.
Hey, man, I already took them.
You just did the most acid I've ever seen anybody eat in my life. Just hope you're not busy for about a month.
Welcome back. In 1938, when a Sandoz Laboratories research scientist in Switzerland named Albert Hofmann stumbled upon a powerful new psychoactive substance he called D-lysergic acid diethylamide, or LSD, he was already a couple of hundred years behind the Indians of Mexico and the U.S. Southwest, who had long been ingesting so-called magic mushrooms, whose active ingredient is a chemical called psilocybin, and slices of peyote cactus, whose active ingredient is called mescaline. But it was LSD, promoted on the East Coast by Dr. Timothy Leary and in the West by the novelist Ken Kesey, that turned the world day-glow in the 1960s.
8 miles high. The purpose of human life is to know yourself and to go within and find out who you are.
Harvard professor Leary pushed a turn-on, tune-in, drop-out philosophy, while Kesey and his acid-stoked merry pranksters celebrated LSD as high old times and inspired the book The Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test. The result of all this LSD consciousness was the birth of a new psychedelic lifestyle in the San Francisco district called the Haight-Ashbury.
That's the situation into which all of a sudden LSD, you know, boom, you know, finally hits the streets. We've all been hearing about it for years, you know, we've read the books and stuff like that, you know, and here it comes. And that was one of the reasons why the Haight-Ashbury was such a great place. You have this community of people that know each other kinda pretty well, you know. All of these people are pot smokers and heads and, you know, they're looking for something, anything. Whether they took acid and went off into the woods, or took acid and went to the acid test, or took acid and contemplated their navel, you know. So, you know, no matter what direction, everybody had gone through these transformations together. You know, when it got really weird in the Haight-Ashbury, we woke up one morning and there was the Gray Lines tour bus out in front of our house.
Favorite pastimes of the hippies, besides taking drugs, are demonstrations.
A number of people took acid trips in the 60s from which they never returned. Nevertheless, the idea of LSD as a spiritual substance, while not unique to deadheads, has been most faithfully cultivated among the band's fans. Right up to today. LSD is a powerful drug that is definitely not recommended for people with established mental problems. Old stories that it caused chromosome damage have since been shown to be unfounded, but then so is the myth that it enhances creativity. Today, LSD is an easy bust for drug police who have targeted Grateful Dead fans in a sting operation. The kids caught in this operation are typically not professional drug dealers of any sort. But because police are allowed to include the weight of the blotter paper in which hits of LSD are contained in sentencing defendants, and because of a legal experiment called mandatory minimums, they can be sent to prison for many, many years. The story of Christian Martinson is typical.
After I got arrested, I really got a warped sense of what justice really is. I was 21 years old when I got arrested. If the government has its way, I won't be out until I'm 30 years old. The main reason why I went on tour with the Grateful Dead was because at 19 and 20 years old, I had absolutely no responsibilities. I figured that traveling around the country that I would find my calling in life, I guess, as it was. I was never selling any drugs prior to this arrest. I was selling t-shirts and food in the parking lots at Grateful Dead shows to support my way around the country. At the shows, doing LSD, it's kind of intertwined with the music. It kind of opens up your senses. It makes it easier, in a sense, to listen to the music.
Taking LSD is like playing Russian roulette with your neurochemistry. We don't go after users. We don't go after Grateful Dead fans. We go after people selling drugs.
In 1991, Christian Martinson was approached by an undercover DEA informant looking for someone to sell him LSD. Martinson found someone with acid to sell and was promised $400 by the informant, money he intended to use to repair his car so he could continue to follow the Grateful Dead.
I met the guy in the parking lot. We hung out and partied. Thought he was actually a pretty good dude. In the 2 years that I knew him, he probably asked me 10 times to purchase LSD before I actually made the deal. The reason why I think he singled me out is because that I was somebody who might have been an easier person to set up. And at that time, I was completely broke living off of friends, and my car was broke down.
One of the main reasons why this needs to happen, because I need to fix my car, man.
My reaction when the door was busted down in the hotel room was nothing but shock.
Don't move, man. I'm gonna blast your head.
When I found out that I could get 10 years, it was utter disbelief. I thought it was a joke.
LSD generally is carried on paper or on a sugar cube or in some medium because it's so small it has to have a carrier to transport it. And so the actual carrier that the LSD is on is weighed in addition to the LSD to determine the total weight of the drug. And then the judge looks at the chart and says, gee, well, you had 5 grams. Well, 4 grams of it may have been paper, and maybe only 1 gram the actual LSD, but the 5 grams is the total weight. Therefore, you're going to get a sentence of 12 years or 15 years.
Paper weighed 126 grams in my case. The actual LSD weighed 1.56 grams. I'm doing 5 years for selling paper.
Do you know how many dosage units he was selling? 20,000 dosage units. You know, 20,000 dosage units, that would last an entire high school for several years.
Of course, he did just introduce the agent to the person who was selling it.
But the agent, without him introducing, would have never been able to make that purchase. See, he was a part of this.
Judges hate mandatory sentencing because it ties their hands, as they say over and over again in sentencing transcripts. It totally takes away their power to do what they were appointed to do, which is, on the merits of the case, decide what the appropriate sentence should be.
They're taking away the discretion, which brings up all of this mandatory minimum stuff, which is truly harmful, probably a hateful policy. But our Congress people are showing that they're tough on crime.
The intention originally of mandatory minimum sentencing was to try and leave a little less discretion to the judges throughout the country, and from at least a federal standpoint, to try and make it a little more uniform in terms of the time that one would spend.
And where does President Bill Clinton stand on mandatory minimum sentences? Here's what he had to say during an MTV political forum.
By and large, there have been a lot of problems with mandatory sentencing programs related to drugs, because they tend to treat cases that are different the same. The system is not as rational as it ought to be, and I do think there's some problems with the sentencing.
I'm not saying not to punish me by any means, but let's make it reasonable.
Third-time child molesters and rapists are getting out before I'm supposed to be getting out in 10 years. Probably the hardest thing about being in prison is the lack of human camaraderie. The emotional and psychological damage is pretty hard to explain unless you've actually been through it. When you're doing 10 or 15 years at a pop, you can't think about, oh, you know, I got 10 more years to do, because it's just, who can deal with that?
Before we take a break, a quick word about another psychoactive drug called MDMA, or ecstasy, which has been all the rage for some years now at rave parties. Ecstasy is actually an amphetamine derivative, and while its effects seem more benign than those of LSD, creating a heightened feeling of empathy and closeness with other people, doctors now believe that MDMA may in fact create permanent brain damage, a possibility worth pondering out there in dance land. When we return, we'll take a look at one of the most insidious drugs in the human pharmacopoeia, heroin. Don't go away.
I hardly ever went out in public when I was on drugs, and I never made a spectacle out of it. I never promoted it. And now I'm going to be associated with heroin for the rest of my life.
Welcome back. Opium, the narcotic juice of the poppy plant and the source of morphine, codeine, and heroin, has been in use for about the past 6,000 years. Medically, as a powerful agent in relieving pain, and recreationally, as quite literally, the stuff that dreams are made of. Over the years, heroin has cut a deadly swath among musicians, making addicts of such jazz and R&B stars as Charlie Parker, trumpet icon Chet Baker, and the great Ray Charles, and more recently, extinguishing the lives of such Seattle rockers as Andrew Wood of Mother Love Bone and Hole bassist Kristen Pfaff. The U.S. response to the heroin problem, jailing addicts and attempting to interdict supplies, has proved exorbitantly expensive and plainly ineffective. One reason for the failure of the government's attempts to suppress the supply of heroin is that the drug now comes flooding in from so many different sources. And as Princeton professor Ethan Nadelman pointed out in a recent Rolling Stone essay, suppressing just one source is pointless.
Every once in a while we have a tiny little success. In the early 1970s we effectively suppressed Turkish opium production, the French Connection. But what happened is the push-down pop-up factor, right? You push down on Turkey and it popped up in Mexico. You push down on Mexico, it popped up in Southeast Asia. You push down in Southeast Asia, it pops up in Southwest Asia. We've now pushed down so many places on illegal opium that it's popped up everywhere. The United States has now become a multiple source heroin importing country.
We may not be stopping it, but we can absolutely dismantle organizations and we can disrupt it. And if we can disrupt it, then we're at least doing something.
In this country, the favored treatment for heroin addiction is another addictive drug called methadone. Under the methadone system, addicts can go to legal clinics to get this drug, which is said to short-circuit the craving for heroin.
This is Lewis, a New Yorker who's been addicted to heroin since he was 13 years old. He's now on methadone maintenance.
What's happening today, heroin is back on the rise, and it's around more than ever, and it's as deadly as ever. The dealers, for want of customers, are cutting the heroin less, so it's more potent. You have a better chance of overdosing. A teenager have a couple of drinks, he's flying high, he's feeling good, and someone says, hey, you want some coke? Sure, they snort that, and they don't know that coke that they're snorting has been cut with heroin. It's not cool to put anything up your nose, just as the same way it's not cool to inject yourself.
It took Lewis 30 years to finally kick his heroin habit. Many addicts appear not to want to trade one addiction for another, especially one that doesn't get them high, and so they remain a part of the violent drug underworld.
A different approach is currently being used in England, where addicts are prescribed regular maintenance doses of the drug, and the crime and violence associated with heroin have been significantly reduced. We paid a visit to a maintenance clinic in Widnes, outside of Liverpool, and met two people, a young woman named Dina and her boyfriend Iggy, for whom heroin has become life itself.
A lot of people are born to learn the hard way. My name is Dina Donnelly. I'm 23 years of age and a registered heroin addict. I attend the drug dependency unit in Chapel Street, Widnes. This is my boyfriend, and he's also a heroin addict. I've been into heroin now for about 4, going in 5 years. Before that, I was injecting amphetamines. It was great, I had a life. Going out raving with my mates. And then one night, I come out of a rave, and I met up with you, didn't I? But he was already caught up with all his mates were into heroin at the time. The thought of heroin frightened me. I hung out for a long time saying, no, I don't want it. But then, because everybody was into it, I took it, I said, yeah. It can take a matter of weeks, a couple of weeks of having it day in, day out, and then you can just say, right, I'm having none of that, I've got no money. You won't have the money to buy it. And then you'll stay in and you'll feel so bad that your body says, go out and get heroin.
If you want to give up drugs, write a medical problem, we'll help you get off drugs. But if you don't and you want to carry on using drugs, there's a way in which you can lawfully do that in England, subject to a strict ration from a doctor, etc. First thing that we'll offer you is detoxification. If you say you don't want to give up drugs, we'll then work out what is the best way, together with yourself, to manage your addiction, which may mean a prescription of drugs.
I've gone into turkeys before, gone into withdrawals. It terrifies me. The thought of withdrawals really does frighten me. I'm very lucky being on the clinic. I am very lucky getting that script.
Hiya.
The way you feel when you haven't had heroin, it's a horrible feeling. It's like having full-blown flu. It's something that you've got to walk around with. And you can't just go to bed and forget about it because you're an addict.
Thanks a lot. Bye.
You've got to have the heroin. They never give you too much. They just about give you too less. There's still some of the same stuff you got yesterday. Yeah. There's a lot more complications to buying street heroin. It's a lot dirtier. With what you get off the chemist, it's clean. There's not powder, face makeup or whatever that's mixed with on the street. It's just clean heroin. I'm not exactly getting a buzz from the clinic heroin. It's just taking away my pains. Being addicted to something like heroin it's horrible. I feel as like I'm going nowhere. I've missed out on a hell of a lot. I'm sorry I ever took it. I had a life. I haven't got a life no more. I've got a routine. You lose your friends, you lose your clothes, you lose your looks. You can lose everything there is to lose. We're addicted, and the clinic understands that we have got a problem and that we need medical help. I mean, I've spent times where I haven't been on the clinic and I've had to go out and get my own heroin. And I've gone out in the states I've been in, but that has given me a lot more gall to go out and steal things or do the things I've done to buy heroin.
Maintaining their habit on heroin or cocaine or whatever their drugs are gives them the space to think about the rest of life, to think about what they're going to do with their life, to think about whether they want to continue taking drugs. Whereas on the black market, their whole day and their whole thoughts are preoccupied with where they'll get their next fix.
Say someone watches this and they'll go, well, that won't happen to me. That's not me. I'm not her. I'm not him. It will. It'll happen to anybody. Anybody who takes it once, it'll happen.
A heroin maintenance program such as the one in Widnes does little to pry addicts away from the drug they choose to take. What it does seem to do is cut way down on the murderous violence associated with the illicit drug trade. And this may be recommendation enough for a crime-weary public. But how to keep young people away from hard drugs in the first place? Well, the Dutch think they have a possible answer to that question, one that involves, among other things, the legitimization of marijuana, as we'll see when we return.
What do I think would happen if they made drugs legal? Holy.
I wouldn't legalize all drugs. Cocaine, for instance, I mean, it's no way. It's people aren't in control when they do cocaine.
There's an opinion that if drugs were legalized, not everybody would do them. But I think it'd still be a big thing.
Police officials are quick to point out that most of the people who seem to be in favor of legalizing drugs in this country always seem to reside in cozy universities or faraway newsrooms. However, the men and women who work for the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration deal with the U.S. drug problem on a daily basis and from a very different perspective. Here in Quantico, Virginia, where they have their training facility, they've even built a mock mini city to give them practice in putting away bad guys.
We're putting our lives on the line. When we suit up, we're thinking this might be it. The gun power and firepower on the street by these hoodlums, by these drug dealers, is far superior to ours. Our training exercises, we go over and over again, they're always changing.
Police! That's why!
That's why DEA is very flexible, because drugs in themselves are very, very flexible. We never really quit working. We have agents that run after school programs.
The best thing I can hope for out of working with these kids is I won't see them 5 years from now on my other side of the job arresting people.
For kids like this, romping on manicured sports fields under blue suburban skies, there's more than a fighting chance of avoiding the drug plague. But how typical are these kids? And if some of them do succumb to drugs in the future, how much help can they expect from a system that looks upon the drug problem as a war?
Perhaps it's time to treat drugs as the health issue they are, rather than indiscriminately throwing users in jail. And perhaps it's also time to start differentiating between drugs. Many young people are drawn to experiment with marijuana, much as they are to alcohol and tobacco. Under the current drug regime, however, these youthful experimenters are forced to enter the illicit drug underworld to procure their pot, and are there exposed to much more harmful substances. No one has followed the implications of this line of reasoning further than the Dutch, as we discovered on a recent trip to Amsterdam. Every day, thousands of people pour into the city of Amsterdam, some of them no doubt attracted by the city's very tolerant drug laws. Officials here have concluded that no matter what government does, some people are always going to take drugs. The Dutch drug idea is to try to minimize the danger that drugs can do, stop demonizing users, and to keep young people away from the hard drug scene, essentially by legitimizing marijuana.
Holland is a very liberal country. It's tolerated and accepted that young people have a certain experimenting phase in their life.
It's not a drug scene here. It's more like an alcohol scene where you sit down in bars and have a good time. This is a quiet place, no fights. It's a lot more relaxed.
I just smoke when I like it, and if I know I've got a lot to do, I don't, because it makes me very dopey.
Coffee shops are nice. They enable people to buy their hash and marijuana in a nice, easy way.
Ah, hi. A member of my party has expressed some interest in getting some of your fine marijuana, and I've been deputized to negotiate the language barrier. What do you have?
The greenhouse crank, too, is the best.
Looks like marijuana. Well, I suppose this person will take some of that.
It's a psychotropic drug.
substance. So, of course, there is also always a danger. And some people get addicted to it because they abuse it. Yeah. But most of the people who use it just use it in a recreational way.
It is said by Dutch authorities that they have less of drug deaths, less of criminality. But other law enforcement agencies in other countries doubt it.
The marijuana kids are smoking today is not the marijuana that the hippies of the 60s were smoking, when the THC content, that's the active ingredient in marijuana, was around 1 in 2%. Do you know that today the THC can be as high as 29%? You can't make a drug decide it's a hard drug or a soft drug. All drugs are bad.
Does drug prohibition effectively reduce drug consumption? I don't think so. I don't see the evidence. Drugs appear to be everywhere. Look at drug-related crime and violence. Look at the prisons overflowing with drug law violators. That's a result not of drugs, but of drug prohibition.
If you don't have law enforcement, you don't have the threat of taking a person's freedom away, they are not going to go get help.
I think the public has to change their opinion about the war on drugs. And the public has to recognize that it's not a war on drugs, it's a war on people. And that people, in fact, are going to prison for long periods of time for very minor infractions.
My brother is a recovering drug addict who actually went to prison for 14 months. It is my opinion that if he hadn't been caught up in the criminal justice system, he probably would have died. So I don't think it's inappropriate for people to do some time for violating serious crimes when they have a drug problem, and it may actually jerk them out of the life they're in and help to save their life. But you've got to have adequate drug treatment as well as preparation for living a different life if you want a different kind of behavior coming out of the prison than you got going in.
It's very humiliating being in prison, the things that you have to go through with strip searches and such things. It's the emotional and psychological damage is pretty hard to explain unless you've actually been through it.
A lot of things is happening now. Young kids just carrying guns. Everything is happening. A lot of things is changing. There's a lot of risk in the drug business. A lot of risk for your life and death.
I don't know what I'm gonna be like if I come off heroin. Even if you've got an endless supply of money to buy it and you don't have to go out robbing, your attitude towards people and friends, it'll change and you'll just become disliked.
I think that if you get into, you know, harder drugs or you get into more regular drug use, you really need to open your eyes and see what's going on. You need to, you know, quit all drug use and keep on going with your life.
As we noted at the top of this show, some people have always taken drugs and they always will. Most are experimenters. A relatively small number become addicts. Drug prohibition has not only had little effect on this phenomenon, it's actually made matters much worse by effectively promoting crime and violence. People make their own decisions about drugs, from alcohol and tobacco to cocaine and heroin, and the best a society can probably hope is that they'll make those decisions based on a clear understanding of what drugs do. Cocaine and heroin can exterminate a person's willpower, one of the more frightening feelings known to humankind. Even marijuana, if sucked up on a daily basis, tends to leave the user somewhat, well, dopey. Being smart about drugs may be the first step in finally doing something about the drug problem. Think about it.